नमस्ते, ग्रीटिंग्स टू एवरीवन। वेलकम टू वीटीयू ई शिक्षण प्रोग्राम। आई डॉक्टर दाक्षायणी आर पाटिल, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर, बीएमएस कॉलेज ऑफ आर्किटेक्चर, बैंगलोर, वेलकम यू ऑल वंस अगेन ऑन बोर्ड दिस कोर्स टाइटल्ड बिल्डिंग सर्विसेज 3, 18 ERC 63 फॉर BArch 6th सेमिस्टर फॉर द करेंट रनिंग E1 सेमिस्टर। So this is an initiative by VTU e-learning center for the benefit of all students. We have been doing modules 1 and 2 under building services 3, dealing with mechanical ventilation and air conditioning systems. We are in the last component of module 2. So that is number 4, specialized air conditioning systems. That is the list of references in the syllabus. So let us proceed with specialized applications. This is lecture number 14. And what we would like to cover here, the course objectives or content. Healthcare facilities and the HVAC considerations under that, server rooms or data center, little preview on theaters and the considerations to be thought about while designing HVAC, hotel, guest rooms. So these four vary in terms of their typology, in terms of the character of the space and the expected HVAC design for each of them. So healthcare facilities and the HVAC considerations. Now we all know that healthcare facilities, the hospitals, clinics, nursing homes, they demand a very unique kind of clean environment indoors. So they have a high expectations of an efficient air conditioning system. So the last session, last lecture number 12 and 13, we looked at clean room aspect under air conditioning. So that was the extreme cleanliness to be achieved in indoors, zero level tolerance for contaminants. So hospital or healthcare have a combination of normal AC that works to the maximum extent and clean room ACs as well. So some of the spaces in healthcare facilities require special conditions of temperature, relative humidity, pressure differential with respect to adjacent spaces. For example, the room here, the lab, the wards, the corridors, each have their own requirement of parameters. And there are common areas like lobbies, canteens. There are extremely critical areas like the operation theaters, ICUs, right? So there is a range of requirement of indoor parameter in a hospital. Cleanliness levels to various degrees and expectations of lower noise levels. So this is a preview of what a healthcare facility would be expecting out of a HVAC. So this is a view of a possible ward with a with adjacent or required components in the ward. So there are different types of thermostats and interface calibrations that are required. Thermostat sensors within the system, exhaust valves. You need to exhaust the air that is in the spaces, the air that is given out by the users, exhaust air has to be taken out. There is, before you enter the actual critical care unit, you have an anteroom. So the anteroom pressure sensors, pressure differential has to be maintained. Anteroom pressure control or monitor outside the before the entry to the unit. There are lots of BAS, building automation systems, in place to control all of these or most of this from a central location in the hospital. So that is the central control BAS, building automation system, which will calibrate and monitor all these aspects across the building centrally located by a technician who is going to take care of this, a system admin or a technician. Anteroom design also is critical before you enter the actual clean room. Isolation room pressure controller and monitor, supply air valve, exhaust air valve, alright. So all these are supposed to be located in the space, ideally with a good interface access and a logical decision in the HVAC system, so as to keep the indoor environment cleaner to the maximum extent. So there is a book released by ASHRAE on HVAC design manual for hospitals and clinics, the latest being the second edition. When lower temperatures are desired in comparison to the general areas, multiple design philosophies are available. So the book discusses on various design philosophies that need to be in place, that need to be adopted while designing a healthcare system. It is quite complex and critical, housing a wide spectrum of spaces having their own requirement of HVAC calibrations in terms of temperature, pressure, velocity and cleanliness. So it's a very holistic, diversified addressal of the entire planning and design. The patient therapy shall be of prime consideration. So the major primary user group in a healthcare facility are the patients who are accessing this facility for objective of being treated for something, being taken care of, or undergoing a therapy. So patient therapy shall be of prime consideration. And the plan shall include clinical services to be provided in each space and the equipment to be used within that space. So when we have the objective or the vision of rendering medical treatment to patients, firstly what has to be thought about is our groundwork or base work has to be ready. The data collection, the literature review, the case studies by which we derive what clinical service is it, an operation, is it a small procedure. There are various medical procedures in place, surgical categories, then it could be just outpatient, inpatient. So all these require specific spatial planning and equipment that will sustain that activity or that treatment therapy. So those equipment have to be noted down, the sizes they come in, the buffer spaces they would want to be accessed by the doctors or nurses. So what is the spatial requirement? Minimum areas of each space has to be reduced and you will get the volume of that space. So that will tell you what is the amount of HVAC calibration that is required. So it's a very systematic process, beginning from user group analysis, clinical procedures, equipment involved, and the spatial manifestation of the same. Secondly, requirement of temperature, humidity, airflow and airflow pattern and pressure gradient with respect to adjacent spaces. So we know that we can have two types of pressure differential, positive and negative. So knowing where to operate, what level or what degree of pressure and positive and negative is essential. So in this, and also airflow pattern, what is the air changes per hour that has to be decided for each space. Temperature, humidity, of course, that is the major criteria of air conditioning. So talking about the airflow pattern or the ventilation aspect, we can see, I have sourced them from some of the service providers. The names are written here. This is an active chilled beam option. So this is the toilet area and this is the actual vault. So this might require 2 ACH, 2 air changes per hour and appropriate restroom exhaustion of the used air. So there will be the register, that is the return air grill to suck in the used air, and the exhaust air duct to take it to the AC appliance equipment to be exhausted, to be treated and exhausted. So now the pressure here is negative. So maintain the restroom at a negative level. So probably the restroom would be a little warmer, would be cooler than what is the ward actually at. All right. So 2 ACH for the toilets. And if you come to the ward, 4 ACH, 6 ACH, that is per hour, the equipment, the AC equipment has to remove the air in the room in its entirety twice if it is 2 ACH from the restroom. From the ward, at least 6 times, the entire volume of the air has to be evacuated and replaced with clean, cool, dehumidified air for the benefit of the users. So that is what. Then you will have different ACH requirements. This is the patient room. So you have the supply air duct getting in that safe air back to the room. So that is how you have to maintain pressure differential and measure the air flow, ventilation aspect of it, and calibrations of temperature and humidity. Now looking at parameters of design for healthcare facility, sourced from National Building Code 2016, India. Temperature and humidity requirements of various spaces is a first parameter. So deciding the ideally required temperature and humidity levels in the given spaces. Ventilation and filtration requirements for contamination control. So conditioning air with respect to temperature and humidity is the experiential quality of the air. Then there is the cleaner perspective, safer perspective, that is ventilation and filtration. So do we use HEPA filter, do we use electronic filter, fine filters, or do we use a combination of these? But are these purifiers enough to capture the viruses, bacteria, right? So the whole question currently is the fight against combating COVID-19, and if our AC systems and filtration systems are adapted to arrest the tiniest of tiny virus. To keep all the patients safer and also the healthcare staff who are the frontline workers. So the working population in a healthcare facility is quite substantial, ranging from the admin section to the medical fraternity, doctors, nurses, to the housekeeping, and to many other supporting personals who are working in the system. So keeping the air safer is a most important prerogative responsibility while designing HVAC. Further, restriction on air movement between adjoining spaces. As much as possible, we would not want the air from one unit to flow into the other unit or get dispersed into the common areas. So there has to be a restriction on how the air moves between, navigates between one place to another. So action taken to limit that is very essential, and how do we do it is what we have to decide with respect to the opening design, with respect to the exhausts, supply ducts, ducting design basically. What is the permitted tolerance on environmental conditions? Deducing that, the system reliability, is the equipment of AC, HVAC, the air handling unit. How reliably are they in place to give the desired conditions, and maintenance, life cycle processes and maintenance also is a very critical aspect. Once we do the initial installation, it is not the end of it. The actual game starts once the equipment comes into usage. Adaptability of the system for fire emergency and for smoke management. This is a very critical requirement because there are lots of susceptible elements that are used in a healthcare facility, oxygen tanks, and so many probably very involving various vaporized gases, liquids. Right, there is anesthesia and all those, probably they are all susceptible to higher degree of fires. So adapting this HVAC system in such a way that it is resistant to fire or able to ward off such kind of emergencies with a good detection and fighting facility such as smoke detection and management. So this is a table in National Building Code which gives guidelines for parameters to be considered for HVAC design for healthcare facilities, right? So the left side you can see list of possible elements, operation theaters, cath labs, delivery rooms, recovery rooms, ICU, endoscopy, bronchoscopy, toilets, so many, X-ray laboratories of various degrees. Sterilizing room, storage, housekeeping, tremendous amount of complexly spaced out activities are seen. So what would be the temperature RH, minimum ACH against these spaces is listed for ready reckoning reference in the NBC. So clause volume 2. Clause number 8.11. Total air change and minimum air change, all that are listed. And what spaces are to be maintained at positive pressure? Which ones need to be at negative and which one equal? Corridors are negative because we do not want the contaminants in the common areas to flow into the critical areas. So critical areas are maintained at a good high pressure. Another table, guidelines for filter efficiency requirement in healthcare facilities. There are four categories: orthopedic related, general OT, ICU related, laboratories, food preparation, laundry, admin, right? So 3 to 10 micron particles, 70% efficiency expected. And here 3 to 10 micron particles, 70% efficiency. So the efficiency of filter systems are mentioned in the table against the various categories noticed. So you can take a look at this table for understanding what is the size of contaminant particle that has to be warded off under each of the categories. Goes up to 0.3 for laboratories, sterile storage areas. Coming to the air distribution system, the ADS shall provide ventilation to dilute and remove the contaminants from the internal spaces. It should assist in controlling transmission of airborne infections, maintaining desired levels of temperature and humidity in the different spaces in the hospital. Design of ADS shall be such that the air movement is from clean areas to lesser clean areas. So that is how we maintain the required pressure differential to achieve this. Recirculation of air should be avoided in critical care areas. So critical care areas are the most crucial, with the high level of clean air to be circulated, and recirculating the air in those areas is not recommended. For critical air care units or areas, constant volume systems, okay, constant air volume CAVs shall be adapted to maintain proper pressure relations and ventilation. Now, the critical areas, some of them listed here: operating theatres, ICUs, isolation rooms, sterile areas, post-operative patient care when the patient is shifted to the ward, or even any space that is housing the medical, surgical procedures and the laboratories where tests are undertaken. This is an example of a COVID-19 pandemic ward, an innovative design. So that panel that you see here is going to arrest the air perspired by the patient right away and not letting it disperse into the other parts of the spaces. It's a new concept, and apparently a company called as Lee Health is working on this currently. The source is of course ASHRAE. So it will be that way demonstrated here. So enabling a hood frame, it's called a hood frame, to arrest the air given out by the COVID patient. Research conducted at Oklahoma City Medical Center, Virginia. Schematic of ventilated headboard, single patient configuration, evaluated at the medical center. So a lot of R&D is happening to provide the best of indoor HVAC systems or ventilation systems in critical care units, especially for the COVID-19. For patient rooms and non-critical areas, variable air volume system shall be considered for energy conservation. So VAV, where we differ the volume of area that is provided through different spaces in order to achieve the required pressure differential. So enabling a healthy airflow and discouraging air from an infected space to go into a non-infected common area space. But care should be taken to ensure that minimum ventilation requirements are not compromised and pressure balance is maintained even at the minimum flow. Because variable air volume, you can monitor or you can calibrate the volume of air. So it should not go so low that it is compromising on the required temperature, pressure or ventilation aspects. Active smoke control systems along with fire and smoke partitions to limit the spread of smoke in the event of fire has to be in place. Smoke and fire management shall be done in accordance with Part 4, the life and safety of the code, as listed in National Building Code 2016. So kindly, anyways, you are referring Part 4 for the firefighting services. In the same, there will be a section on this particular topic. A separate exhaust system shall be provided for removal of anesthetic gases from the operation theater. These are flammable gases, and there has to be a dedicated exhaust system to remove these gases from the zones, either from the system or unintentional leakage or anything that could possibly happen. Alternatively, proper isolation dampers may be provided in the air circulation system for removal of the anesthetic gases or fumigation effect. Fumigation, we have has seen a lot of occurrence in the past 1.5 years, where post-COVID there has been an increase in the need to sanitize different spaces, especially where there is a public gathering or involving healthcare facility. So fumigation will disinfect the entire space by letting out the disinfectant gas into the space, and then it is extracted out. So HEPA unit, the best possible filtration systems, to return with protective tent. Lots of various design options are available. You can explore, you can do a literature study and understand what are the new innovations in the HVAC for healthcare facilities. So, compliant with ASHRAE codes, HEPA discharging directly to the exterior non-HEPA rooms, but there are fans, and discharge directly to the exterior. So various options are possible. The architect, along with the service provider, contractor, engineer, has to deliberate on the best possible option and design the spatial layout in such a way as to cater to it. So ASHRAE has a lot of technical resources on their website, and under that specifically healthcare, that can be accessed as a post-course study. Air handling devices shall be designed to prevent water intrusion. They should permit access for inspection and maintenance. That's a very important thing when we design mechanical equipment. One-time installation is not the end of the story. There is a continued cycle of maintenance, repairs, recharging, etc. So it has to have, that also has to be thought of when we design a building and its interiors. Post-occupancy functioning is very critical. Fibrous acoustic insulating material shall not be used as a duct lining for critical spaces, because these fibrous acoustic insulating material will themselves give away lint and residue into the indoor air. Supply air duct shall be externally insulated as required. The supply air duct is the one which is carrying the cooled, cleaned air, and it is passing through the plenum, which is not air conditioned, that is hot air outside. So we have to ideally insulate the supply air ducts in an efficient manner. Multiple direct drive plenum fans may be used in AHU serving critical areas. So multiple direct drive plenum fans on the ceiling can be used in AHU serving critical areas. This provides redundancy and minimizes shutdown of critical areas in case of single fan failure. So backup is most essential in these kind of healthcare facilities and such buildings. Power failure and stopping of certain life saving devices should not happen, leading to fatalities and adverse conditions. For critical areas, both supply air and return air shall be ducted. Ducts shall be sized for minimum velocity and pressure drop, so they do not create turbulence nor noise, because if it were high velocity, minimize the pressure drops to increase the efficiency. For applications like OTs, ICUs, preferred material for ductwork should be aluminum sheet. Ultraviolet germicidal irradiation is recommended for AHU for extensive cleaning of the system and the exhausted fan. Lamps may be installed either upstream or downstream of the evaporator coil, but away from the filter media. So UV upstream of coil, downstream airflow. So this is a section of a possible AHU design. UV lamps installed inside an air handling unit, AHU. So they help in excessive deep disinfection and cleaning the air, supporting the already existing filtration system. Coming to airflow and filtration system, outside air intakes should be at least 8 meters away from the exhaust stacks, cooling tower, or any other polluting source. You're getting fresh air bypass, which is required to mix with the used air and dilute it. Now, these kind of outlets where you're placing the points of outside air coming in should be away from the exhaust stacks, right? Exhaust stack is giving away the dirty air outside. If you place the outside air intake grill or window, it is going to extract the dirty air back into the space. Very harmful. So at least 8 meters away from the exhaust, cooling tower, or any other polluting source. Bottom of an outside air intake shall not be located less than 2 meters above the ground level and 1 meter above any terrace level. So some of the guidelines that we have to remember while designing HVAC for a healthcare facility. Exhaust outlets, the point where air is thrown away, should be at a minimum height of 3 meters away from ground level and away from doors, occupied areas, or operable windows. The locating of exhaust outlets above the roof, projecting upwards, is preferred. So when you exhaust, it goes on to the top and doesn't necessarily be sucked in into the system again. While installing filters, care shall be taken to see that there is no scope for leakage between frame and filters and between filter segments. So bad man, workmanship is very critical, and adverse impacts can be seen. So foolproof of the system and installation of filters is essential. All openings in ducting and diffuser collars shall be sealed to prevent infusion of dust and dirt. All slab openings shall be terminated in enclosed rooms. Airflow systems shall be designed and balanced to create positive or negative air pressure within the specified areas as required. Positive, negative. Supply air outlets should be ideally located near or at the ceiling, returns near the floor level. This is to ensure that clean conditioned air moves through the breathing and working space to the floor area for return. So it is like flushing the room from a clean air from top. For operating room and the procedure room, where patients are highly susceptible to infection, such as orthopedic and cardiac operating theaters, laminar airflow system is advisable. So HEPA filters on the roof, on the ceiling, sorry, and giving away the cooled, clean air downwards draft and then sucked in. So conditioned air, return air grills shown there, and the influx of fresh air. Unidirectional airflow pattern at a velocity of 0.45 plus or minus 0.1 meters per second advisable. Area of laminar flow grid shall extend by a minimum of 450 mm beyond the footprint of the operating table on all sides. Additional supply diffusers may be provided. So as much as possible, the supply air inlet has to be substantial. Exhaust grills, minimum 2, shall be provided at opposite corners of the room at approximately 200 mm above the floor level. So we have seen, we are going to exhaust it at the floor level. Ventilated with a re, it should be, I mean, these kind of facilities should be ventilated with recirculated air supplied through the HEPA filters only. HEPA filters are the best 98% efficiency, very reliable. Protective environment rooms such as bone marrow transplants and organ transplants shall be maintained at a positive pressure of 2.5 with respect to the surrounding spaces. These have to be noted down when we are undertaking healthcare facility designs. Now coming to AC equipment itself, cooling shall be advisable, central or chilled water systems, direct expansion type condensing units or VRF systems can be adopted. We have seen these in detail in the module 2 section 3 lectures, if you can recollect. Indirect cooling systems using chilled water is preferred. Heating equipment shall be of heat pumps, boilers or heat exchangers ideally. So selecting the right equipment with the right capacity and objectives serving our requirement is important. Alright, so that's it. So next lecture number 15, we will look at HVAC considerations for server rooms, theatres and hotel guest rooms. Alright. So until then, meet you on the next side for the next lecture. Thank you.